हेलो फ्रेंड्स, माय सेल्फ डॉक्टर नंद कुमार रावबावले फ्रॉम कॉलेज ऑफ इंजिनियरिंग अंबाजोगाई इज गोइंग टू डील विथ अप्लाइड थर्मोडायनामिक्स टू. दिस इज अवर 20th लेक्चर. इन प्रीवियस लेक्चर वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट फंक्शंस ऑफ एयर कंडीशनिंग एंड क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ एयर कंडीशनिंग सच एज विंटर एयर कंडीशनिंग, समर एयर कंडीशनिंग, ईयर राउंड एयर कंडीशनिंग, विंडो एयर कंडीशनिंग एंड स्प्लिट एयर कंडीशनिंग सिस्टम. And finally, we discussed about central air conditioning system. Now, today we are going to discuss about the types of fossil fuels, then petroleum products, that is the sources of energy. Today we are discussing sources of energy, in that we are going to discuss in brief about what a fossil fuel is, petroleum products, then hydro energy, nuclear fuel and wind energy, tidal energy, geothermal energy. So now the main sources of energy are such as we have discussed in today's content, that is fossil fuel, then petroleum products, hydel energy, nuclear fuels, then wind energy, tidal energy, geothermal energy. So these are the sources of energy for power plant. So it may be a thermal power plant, it may be a nuclear power plant, or it may be a wind plant, or it may be a tidal or geothermal plant. So these kinds of fuels are used to run various types of power plants. So now, what this fossil fuel is? So the fossil fuels are nothing but the hydrocarbons and primarily coal or fuel oil or natural gas. And these are formed from the remains of dead plants and animals. So in ancient period, animals and plants were buried into the earth crust, and from that, so these fuels are formed. And the term fossil fuel is also includes hydrocarbon containing natural sources that are not derived from animal or plant sources. So the fossil fuels, in the sense the fuels which are obtained in the earth crust and which are formed by the dead plants and animals, are primarily referred as the fossil fuels. So these fossil fuels are extracted by excavation process and used for converting the energy contained in it by combustion of such fuels into the useful work. That is a mechanical work, then converting it into electrical energy and transmitting it for various purposes. So now, second is a petroleum product. So petroleum product is also called as a crude oil, and it is also one of the fossil fuel. So like natural gas, coal or petroleum, it was formed from the ancient marine organisms such as plants, algae, bacteria, which converted due to long duration, and by conversion of those petroleum products such as crude oil is formed, and that is converted into various sub products such as petrol, diesel and so on. So this is another kind of source of energy for power plant. Then hydel energy. So hydel energy is nothing but the energy which is extracted by the water which is flowing, that is the moving water, and that water is moving because of gravitational force, because of altitude difference from higher level to the lower level. So you might have seen the waterfall. So the waterfall where water is flowing by natural process and because of gravity, and such waterfalls are converted into hydel power plants, and energy from potential energy of water, which is converted into kinetic energy, and that kinetic energy is converted into form of mechanical energy of the devices, and through which the mechanical energy is thereby converted into electrical energy and transmitted for the use. Now, nuclear fuels. What this nuclear fuel is? Nuclear fuel is nothing but a material used for nuclear power stations to produce heat, and that heat is converted into power. So here, heat created by the nuclear fuel undergoes nuclear fission process. So the nuclear fuel undergoes nuclear fission process. So most of the nuclear fuels contain heavy fissile actinide elements that are capable of undergoing a sustaining nuclear fission. So if a fuel undergoes fission process, fission and fusion processes, then the lot of energy is liberated by fission process of nuclear fuel, and that energy which is liberated in the form of heat is used to generate power. So in detail we are going to discuss about nuclear reactor and nuclear power plant. So just as an introduction, what the sources of energy are and what is the nuclear fuel and all that we are going to discuss today. So now another form of energy is wind energy. So this wind energy is formed because of solar energy only. So this movement of sun and heat irradiated by sun, so wind is going to flow on the earth crust. So main cause of wind energy is solar energy. So this wind energy or wind power describes the process by which wind is used to generate electricity. You might have seen many more windmills mounted over the hill stations, and those wind turbines are converting the kinetic energy of wind into mechanical work, and that mechanical work is converted into, what you say, electrical power, and is transmitted and connected to the grid. So now moving to the tidal energy. So this tidal energy is obtained in the ocean, where the tides in the sea are harnessed by converting the energy, that is the tides energy or tidal energy is converted using the turbines or the mechanisms, mechanical devices to convert the tidal energy into mechanical work, and that mechanical work is converted into electrical energy. So although not yet widely used, so this tidal energy is not widely used, but it has got large potential for future electricity generation. So India's borders, more than 50% of Indian border is converted by ocean, is covered by ocean. Therefore India has got large potential for getting energy from tides of ocean. Then geothermal energy. So it is seen that in the earth crust there is a large amount of heat energy, and that heat energy is extracted by various methods, and that heat energy which is extracted from the earth crust or within the earth is known as a geothermal energy. So this word geothermal energy comes from the Greek word that is geo means earth and therm means heat. So therefore geothermal energy, that is the energy or heat energy obtained from earth itself, is known as geothermal energy. So the geothermal energy is one kind of renewable energy. Geothermal energy, wind energy, tidal energy, all these are renewable sources of energy, and this geothermal energy is produced continuously within the earth surface, and that geothermal energy or heat energy in the earth crust is extracted for producing various or for getting various kinds of works done over the earth. So that is used for bathing as well as to heat the building or to generate electricity. So many times you might have heard that there is a lake in which half of the water is cold and half of the water is hot. So that is nothing but the geothermal energy is coming out of earth, and because of that half of the lake, or sometimes you can find some hot springs on the earth crust over the earth crust. So that is nothing but the result of geothermal energy. So that heat energy is utilized for various purposes. So now thermal power plant. What is a thermal power plant? A mechanism or device, we can say, or a set of devices in which the fuel is burned and heat energy extracted from the combustion of fuel is utilized to generate water, generate steam from water. And this steam generated is utilized to generate mechanical power with the help of a turbine by expanding steam in the turbine. And the steam which comes out of this turbine is condensed in a condenser. Again, this condensate coming out of the condenser is used as a feed water to the boiler. again this feed water when is passed into the boiler, again it is converted into steam. So thermal power plant is nothing but the device or set of devices which converts the heat energy produced by combustion of fuel into steam, and that steam is expanded in the turbine, and by expansion of steam in the turbine, heat energy is converted into mechanical work, and that mechanical work or turbine is coupled with the generator, electrical generator, where electrical energy is produced, and that is transmitted to the national grid, and from which it is distributed to various places for its use. So now we are going to discuss about a general layout of thermal power plant, what it consists of. So now first of all we will see the coal cycle there. So very first you can find here, this is the coal storage. So from which the coal is passed to the coal handling devices. So in this coal handling devices, this coal is converted into powder form, that is pulverized coal, is supplied into the boiler for combustion. When the fuel is burned here in this boiler, so heat is liberated, and the ash formed in this boiler is taken by ash handling devices, and ash is stored or disposed of. So ash handling devices are going to take this ash formed into the boiler. After combustion, it is taken by ash handling devices, and it is stored somewhere, or it is disposed of by various mechanisms. So this is how coal is going to flow. So now for combustion of coal, air is required. So this air is taken from atmosphere here, and through the filter it is passed, and then it is passed through the air preheater, where air is preliminary heated by recovering heat from the flue gases, and this air which is preheated is hot air. Then it is passed into the combustion chamber of boiler or boiler furnace. So where the hot air will not quench the fire, or it will not reduce the temperature or the combustion process. So therefore this hot air is passed into this boiler where it is utilized for combustion purpose. So when this flue gases are formed, so those flue gases are going to used in the boiler to generate steam, and then these flue gases are passed through superheater, and then these flue gases are passed into the economizer, where some amount of heat energy which it contains is given to the feed water in this economizer. So from this side feed water comes, and the heat transfer takes place from flue gases to the feed water, and then these flue gases are taken out, and then these hot gases, so partially cooled but still it has got some amount of heat energy, so that flue gases are passed into this air preheater, where again the amount of heat which is present in this flue gases are passed to the air, fresh air. Here also heat exchange takes place in air preheater, and then flue gases are moving to the chimney, where this is a tall structure, and where the flue gases are passed into the atmosphere at a very high altitude, so that the pollution in the nearby area will be less, and drought can be achieved. So there are two functions of this chimney. One function is to discharge flue gases at a high altitude, and second is to reduce the pollution, and third one is the height of chimney helps us to produce drought, or automatically these gases will flow into the atmosphere. Then afterwards it comes that the water cycle. So here the feed water is supplied to the economizer. So water supplied to the economizer, where it gains heat from flue gases, and this hot water enters into the boiler when it converts into the steam, and then steam is superheated in the superheater, and the steam which is superheated is taken out from superheater, and it is expanded into this steam turbine. So this is a steam turbine. So first part it is HP, high pressure stage, then intermediate pressure, and then low pressure. So steam is expanded into three stages, and when the steam is expanded in the HT turbine, some sort of steam is taken out as a blending steam. So for heating purpose of feed water, as well as to improve some efficiency, that is regenerative cycle and reheat cycle. So again, some part of steam is taken for after intermediate pressure and then after complete expansion. So this steam which is coming out of this turbine after complete expansion at low pressure side, then it is passed into the condenser, and this steam is condensed in the condenser, that is converted into the liquid, and that condensate is taken by this condensate extraction pump. Again, this condensate is passed through low pressure heater where it is heated, then again it is passed through the high pressure heater, and then by the help of this feed pump, this steam is passed into the economizer and boiler. So this is the water cycle. Then third one is the condenser, in which the cooling water is required to condense the steam. So steam is hot gaseous, in the hot gaseous form. So this steam has to be condensed, therefore the heat from steam has to be rejected, therefore the cooling water is pumped into this condenser, where the heat from steam is given to the cooling water and it becomes hot. Again, this hot water is passed into the cooling tower, just like a building like structure, from where the water is spread in the fine water droplets. And when this water gets connected, or when gets mixed with the air, so here some part of water gets evaporated by absorbing latent heat of vaporization, and remaining part of water gets collected into the sump at the bottom of this cooling tower. Again, this cooled water is circulated into the condenser. In this way, heat of this steam is rejected to the atmosphere, into this cooling tower. Again, sometimes, so here, generally, some water is going to get evaporated, so makeup water has to be added into this sump. Similarly, into this boiler also, some pure water is required to be supplied as a feed water, because some water losses are going to occur in this water cycle also. So then here, this is about the cooling water cycle, then steam cycle, cool cycle, air cycle. Now, after expansion of steam into the turbine, so heat energy is converted into mechanical work, and that turbine is coupled with the generator, and this generator produces electrical energy, and that is passed to the transmission tower, or it is supplied to the national grid. So national grid is going to supply this electricity or electrical energy generated in a thermal power plant for various applications. So then what are the factors, or how the thermal site for thermal power plant is selected? So there are major five factors which are considered for selection of thermal power plant. So very first factor is available of resources. So what kind of resources are required? So to erect a thermal power plant, land is required, whether land is available or not. So if land is available in nearby location, there must be abundant quantity of water. Then availability of fuel, so it may be a coal or diesel or any other kind of fuel, whether it is available or not in that region, that is to be seen. Then skilled manpower is also required for working into this thermal power plant. So availability of resources, so man and material, so whether it is available in that region or not. If we are going to select a site where water is not available, then it is very difficult for us to run the thermal power plant in such a desert like location. Therefore, while selecting the site for thermal power plant, all these factors are seen, that is availability of resources. Then second factor is economical impact. So land acquisition cost, if land is available but the land is very much fertile and the cost of land is very much high, then it may not be economical. Then investment cost, then operation and maintenance cost of this thermal power plant, whether a kind of thermal power plant which we are going to install requires what kind of maintenance and operation. that has to be seen. If the thermal power plant is located into the coastal areas, so the because of humidity, parts are going to get corroded and maintenance becomes very costly. And then payback period. So if you are investing or government is investing for setting up a thermal power plant, so how much will be duration to get the money invested for installing a power plant, that has to be seen. Then future developments. So if you want to expand thermal power plant, initially if you are going to install 210 megawatt power plant, and in future if someone wants to expand one more unit, that is 210 megawatt nearby, then whether it is possible for the government to install or to expand the power plant capacity or not, that is to be seen. Then possibility of site expansion, that is site whether site can be expanded or not, that has to be seen. Then comes to the environment concern. So environment concern is nothing but degradation of local air quality. So because of combustion of fuel, large quantity of flue gases are liberated into the atmosphere, and it happens that the quality of air in the nearby region is going to degrade. So whether the quality of air is already degraded, and if you are going to degrade it further, then it will be very harmful to the people living in that area. Therefore, it has to be seen whether the quality of air in that region is whether impure or pure. If it is pure, then we can install the thermal power plant so that the addition of impurities into the air may not lead to the severeness of environment problem. Then land use impacts. So by using this thermal power plant, what are the other impacts? Sometimes the dust and noise is also one of the problem. So when thermal power plant is erected, so it liberates dust in the form of ash, whereas noise is also produced by the thermal power plants or any kind of power plant. So this is also environment concern. So where the people in the region, if they take action or they are opposing for such things, then one cannot select the site. Then effect on water bodies. So if you are using installing a thermal power plant, so impurities may be discharged into the river or lake, so that will be affecting on water bodies or water sources in that region. So what kind of impact it will have, that has to be seen. Then third one is social concern. So in the social concern, the job creation opportunities for the youth in that area, then public acceptance. So whether the public is going to accept for such system in that area, then number of relocations and distance from public area, whether it is close to the public area or not. If it is away from public area, then it will not create much of the problem. Otherwise, it creates the problem, or public will take the objection for installation of such thermal power plant. Then last point is accessibility. So whether the approach for this thermal power plant is proper or not. So it should be connected with road, rail and airport accessibility, so that the necessary infrastructure can be delivered to the site, as well as the experts can also visit to the site. For that, it must be well connected by road, rail and airport. So rail is very important for thermal power plant, because the coal has to be transmitted to the thermal power plant, and that can be transmitted, a large quantity of coal can be transmitted only with the help of a rail. So therefore, whether the site is close to the rail system or not, that is to be seen. Then transmission to grid accessibility. So grid connectivity should be easily available, or transmission lines should pass through nearby area, then it will help. Then electricity consumption point, as well as urban area accessibility. So if it is very close to the urban area, then it helps the people for working in the power plant, as well as for the facilities required for power plant, can be attained early if it is close to the urban area or city area, if it is in the remote area, then accessibility to the people working in the power plant will be very less, and therefore many people may not be willing to work in such areas, backward areas. So therefore it should be near to the city or urban area. So now these are the factors for site selection of thermal power plant. So now we will be discussing next in next lecture about the diesel power plant and gas turbine plant. So we are dealing now with the fifth unit, and in the sixth unit. So in fifth unit, first part is just over, that is sources of energy. Second part already we have discussed in applied thermodynamics one, that is Rankine cycle, reheat cycle, regenerative cycle, reheat regenerative cycle. So some part of this second chapter in unit 5 is going to remain, that we will take at the last after completion of sixth unit. So we stop here, and in next class we will discuss about diesel power plant. Thank you.